Before I hand the floor over to Mike, I would also just like to tell you a little bit about why Mike's here. We are, as many of you might already know, holding at the moment an event called Songhubs Auckland 2017. And Songhubs is an event where we bring exceptional, amazing international guests like Mike, Emily Warren, James Newman and Zach Gurkha across to work with our local artists to collaborate and to make music together. And there are a couple of reasons why we do it. One is, of course, to create songs, but another probably more important reason for doing it is because it builds this extraordinary collaborative community of creative people. You know, our industry is pretty small as it is already, but it can only be helped by creating relationships between people and allowing them to explore a creative process through the eyes and perspectives of another person. And so through this event, we give people a chance to work with artists and genres that they would never have perhaps explored before, and to learn from people with incredible experience and wisdom and perspective, such as the amazing people that we've got here at the moment. So it's a really special and fantastic thing. And it's also, as well as something that produces songs as it happens, because after this week, we'll have 20 new songs in the world, each of which get written in the space of just a few hours. We also then have the kind of long game in mind, where over the next 18 months to 2 years to 3 years, these songs make their way out into the world and the relationships that people have formed start to flourish and develop and then move and cross-pollinate into other parts of the musical world. And that happens both here, across the Tasman, and internationally as well. So it's a kind of a way of developing and building and feeding into this kind of incredible creative whirlpool that we've got down in this part of the world. And it's really exciting. I'd also just like to say that this would not be remotely possible without incredibly generous support from our partners in crime, the first being New Zealand On Air, who have been amazing with their support. Auckland Council, also amazing. Recorded Music New Zealand, also amazing. I'm using the same adjective over and over again. And finally, the New Zealand Music Commission, who has also been amazing. And it's also not possible without an incredible team at APRA helping to put this all together. And there are a lot of people working very hard behind the scenes to kind of create this opportunity for people in our industry that we will all be hearing a lot more from in the future. So, without further ado, oh, I forgot Greg Haver, the man of the hour. I better not admit the incredible curatorial force that Greg Haver is and what he has done with this initiative and how he creates such an extraordinary chemistry in this space and allows all of this to happen. Thanks, Greg. So here we have Mike Elizondo. I don't really think that you need much of an introduction. So what I thought I would do instead, because you don't really want to listen to me talk to the rest of the night, is that I'm just going to read out a list of some of the people that, and some, it's really just some, of the people that Mike has collaborated with, and then we can just talk about it. This might take a minute. Eminem, Regina Spektor, 50 Cent, Fiona Apple, Maroon 5, Jinwig Moore, Avenged Sevenfold, Dr. Dre, Nelly Furtado, Mastodon, Snoop Dogg, Wendy and Lisa, Kimbra, Mary J. Blige, Sheryl Crow, Liz Phair, Linkin Park, Gwen Stefani, Busta Rhymes, Alice Cooper, Eric Clapton, Burt Bacharach, Luther Vandross, wow. Christina Aguilera, Nas, Rihanna, Ry Cooder, B.B. King, Jay-Z, Carrie Underwood, Alanis Morissette, Keith Urban, and 21 Pilots. And that's not the whole list. So I now am going to hand over to Mike and say, how do you possibly imagine or plan for a career like that?
Well, first of all, I just want to say, you know, thanks for coming. You always wonder, like, I walked in here and it was completely empty about 20 minutes ago, so it's nice to see everybody here. This is amazing, an opportunity to get to come visit. You know, this has definitely been a bucket list for a long time to just see your beautiful country, and it's far surpassed my expectations so far. And it's been really inspiring to get to meet all the great artists and the writers, and you know, like you said, I mean, I think it's a equally, you might look at it as you're getting an opportunity to work with us, but I equally feel like I'm getting an opportunity to meet a lot of incredible artists and see all that New Zealand has to offer. So thanks for having me, and thanks for putting this on. She reads that list, and I kind of, it doesn't even seem real to me, because I just sort of wake up every day and I'm just grateful that I get to go and make music with some talented people and have found my way to, you know, navigated my way somehow, some way to some of those amazing artists, you know, it's, you know, it's beyond me how it happened. I'm just grateful that it did. But I think the main thing is that I just showed up every day and did, you know, follow my instincts and just did the best that I had that day. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. You know, for every one of those, I mean, there's, you know, 10 times as many of artists that I maybe had the opportunity to work with and it just didn't work out, you know, but you're grateful for when it does and it's a success. And it just means that you maybe get a few more, you add a little bit more time and longevity to your career, but you still have to wake up the next day and work just as hard and not sort of rest on your laurels. Like, okay, I had a big hit or a big, you know, record. Now everyone's just gonna love everything I do. You know, you really have to sort of keep that mentality of just sort of, you know, hustle and grind and not take any of it for granted and hope that there's another one at some point down the road. I don't really base my success on whether something was a hit on radio or sold, you know, umpteen million copies. You know, I try and just look at the integrity of the artists that I'm working with and the music that we create and hope that it reaches an audience. And you know, for me, that success is that, you know, someone shows up to that artist concert and buys a t-shirt and maybe becomes a fan. You know, ultimately, it's not, I don't know, I don't really gauge it on sales or how many number ones. I just try and gauge it on the impact it's having. And fortunately, it's been a lot of fun these last, I don't know, almost 20 years now that I've kind of been doing it in this capacity.
So how did it begin then? Where did you start?
I grew up in Los Angeles in a suburb, you know, San Fernando Valley suburb. And I had a musician father, so I was exposed to music really early, as far as a great record collection, but also just seeing musicians come to the house and jam was really impactful. So I started off by wanting to be in a band and emulate my dad. And I was in a band that eventually got signed to Atlantic Records. We made an album. It was the first time I got to be in a studio. We made an album. Album got shelved and never came out. And I was totally devastated. I thought, well, that's it. You know, I'm 22 years old and that's it. Okay, now I'm going to have to go get a real job and became a telemarketer for a little bit, you know, sold some ink toner, you know. And it was really humbling, but I kind of just figured, okay, I got to figure something else out and started to do some writing just with anybody and everybody. Did some writing and little by little I started to get some session work as a bass player. And got to meet some really great producers and some great artists. And along the way, I had a buddy who became a runner at a recording studio that Dre was working at, Dr. Dre, not to be confused with any other Dre. And Dre was looking for some new musicians, and my buddy threw my name in the hat. And I kind of, you know, found my way doing a lot of session work for Dre and a lot of his other producers. And at the time, he had just started Aftermath. His label, and it was just another session, you know, another day, and I'd get a call back to do another session for some of his producers, and eventually, you know, kind of found my way doing more sessions for Dre himself, and this was before he signed Eminem, and, you know, it's really just kind of reinventing himself through this new label venture, and I was just, you know, kind of there for it as it was another gig, you know, just trying to make a living as a bass player. And doing some writing on the side, and it just kind of kept evolving from there. You know, what I thought was just going to be a couple of, you know, gigs on a couple rap records ended up becoming 11 years of making records and learning to make records from one of the greats. So really that meeting with Dre was what kind of became the catalyst, and he kind of gave me the environment to learn how to, you know, arrange a song and how to mix a song and how to inspire an artist and develop, you know, sign, you know, find a new artist and develop a career from scratch, and you know, and even, you know, how to manage your money, all that stuff. I mean, he was the best, you know, mentor I could have ever hoped to have, and continues to be a good friend that I kind of go to for advice. But yeah, Dre was really the one that kind of gave me my first shot and experience.
So you landed in a really deeply hip-hop environment and a rap environment.
Right.
But is that what, is that the kind of musical direction that you had thought you would take? Or did you start in a totally different place?
Yeah, I was, at the time, I was playing in more like rock bands and, you know, pretty heavy rock bands. And rap was probably the music I listened to the least, if at all, you know, which was kind of funny, you know, to wind up being there. My brothers, who were huge rap fans, were really excited that I was going to get to hang out with Dre and, you know, get to, you know, they'd ask me stories, you know, just tell me anything, you know. And then I'd get to bring them as you know, once Eminem and 50 Cent and some of those other guys started to rise, you know, I'd bring my brothers to the studio because they're really the ones that kind of educated me in the early days. But I think I had, you know, I'd say about 90% of what my career is today, I had no idea I'd be doing. And I had no idea I even had talent to do. I was thinking as far as just being in a band playing bass was as far as I can imagine. And, you know, so when I meet Dre, it was really a complete learning experience of just what he was looking for, trying to figure out how to keep a gig as a bass player. And it turned out that I started to write bass lines for some of these songs that went on to be big hits. And then it became beyond bass, playing guitar, playing keyboards, arranging, taking on more production roles. But, you know, it was kind of, I think the fact that I didn't have a huge background in hip-hop was what made it work. Dre handled the hip-hop part of it and taught me how to kind of, you know, program beats. But I brought something that was coming more from a Beatles and old Motown and R&B, you know, that we kind of had some similarities in our record collection, but a lot of it was very different. And I'd kind of try and find sounds that felt like Radiohead and figure out a way to sneak it onto an Eminem track, you know. Even just a lot of my heavier influences like Metallica and Iron Maiden and Judas Priest, you know, a lot of those guitar riffs are things that I sort of emulated on a lot of like Eminem, some of his edgier, and even if I wasn't playing it on guitar, sometimes I would play it on a synth sound. But if you kind of analyze it, it's really kind of coming from a more sinister kind of rock harmonic content. So it just sort of worked out somehow.
And so that's how you made that transition from being an instrumentalist to being a producer in that situation.
Yeah, it would evolve. I mean, there were times I would show up and, you know, do everything from playing a shaker and playing a string arrangement and playing some guitar and some bass. And it just depends on what was needed. But the more I added, the more Dre started to give me, you know, free rein to, you know, there'll be times where he would just say, hey, just add whatever you hear on this, and he'll come. He would leave the studio, I would work on it, he'd come back in, pick the best parts and show me, teach me pretty much what was good and what wasn't based on what he thought, and give me production credit along the way.
And you worked with him for about 10 or 11 years.
Yeah, pretty much 11 years straight I was on call to whatever he wanted to do.
So then how does a person working with Dr. Dre, who probably then gets, the perspective is that you are a hip-hop composer, performer, producer, how do you then start working with Fiona Apple?
Right, yeah, I mean, that was a bit of a stretch.
Was it going to be her first rap album?
I mean, yeah, Fiona, I actually, a lot of people maybe don't know this, I mean, I don't know why you would know this, but I actually played string bass in the orchestra for Fiona's second album. So if you look, well, if anybody has CDs anymore, if you look at the credits somewhere in the liner notes, you'll see my name as the bassist in the string orchestra for about four songs on her second album, When the Pond. So within 6 years, I think it's more a testament to how long she takes in between records than anything I did. But within those 6 years, managed to go from playing in the string orchestra for her album to producing the next album. And that came about through a friendship with John Bryan.
Right.
And so even though I was doing a lot of hip-hop stuff, I was still managing to maintain my relationship with a lot of musicians as a bass player. And so I'd get calls from Ry Cooter, who's an incredible guitarist, to play on a Mavis Staples record, or T-Bone Burnett would call me to play on a B.B. King record, which actually turned out to be the last B.B. King studio album that was recorded in 2008. You know, so a lot of really cool musicians that I would meet along the way, and John Bryan being one of them. You know, as I started to get these credits in, you know, on all these big hip hop records, a lot of the guys who knew me as a musician, you know, or some of the people who worked at these labels who knew me as a musician would go, hey, why don't we put Mike? We know he can, you know, he can speak music, you know, let's let's see what happens if we if he applies whatever he's done with Dre. But Fiona, it was totally her call to bring me in, and John introduced me, and we hung out for a couple of days, and eventually I, you know, found myself kind of, you know, taking on production for her third album. So it just kind of worked out, and without a doubt, having a Fiona Apple credit alongside of a Dr. Dre credit is what my whole career has been based on, you know, just being able to sort of straddle both of those types of genres, where you've got something that can be very intensive musically and harmonically, but then also have the simplicity of what hip hop is sort of known for. And that's pretty much what I've kind of just built a career out of. And after Fiona Apple, that led to Maroon 5. Mm. And after Maroon 5, that led to, you know, a number of other things, fortunately. Mm. And then beyond that, it's sort of, I wanted to bring it full circle and find some, you know, no one would take me seriously when I said I wanted to produce a metal band. And so I kept, you know, bugging my manager, bugging different label guys. And I'm like, I don't know, you know. And fortunately, I basically just, you know, convinced, you know, the manager of Avenged Sevenfold to have them take a meeting with me. And I, you know, I was able to show them that, you know, my metal knowledge, and impress them enough to want to make their record. And, you know, it was a number one album, and I did the album after that, which was also number one record for them, and, you know, had a lot of, you know, modern rock hits on it. And and then that led to doing another metal band named Mastodon. Yeah. And so I've kind of, like, I don't know, for whatever reason, for me, it's fun. Mm. Because I literally had a, and I'm not just saying this or whatever, but it was the most bizarre time was when I did Gary Clark Jr., then I went to Regina Spektor, then I went to Carrie Underwood, and then I went to Mastodon. And I'm like, okay, thank you, Lord. I mean, this is like my dream, you know, it's 100% the dream I'd hoped for as a bass player, but then to get to be as a producer and a co-writer, where a lot of those people was beyond me. It's pretty fun.
Next stop, Shania Twain.
Yeah, maybe.
You know, but you've worked in country music as well, not with Shania, but with Keith Urban.
Yeah. There's been a handful of country writers and that I've become very close with, and some artists as well.
So I think that probably lots of us are quite fascinated to know what goes on in a studio environment, going back to the whole kind of Dr. Dre environment to start with. You know, the swag of all of that music and everything that you hear and what they talk about. What is a studio environment like with Snoop Dogg and Dre and everybody hanging out?
It's, you know what, it's a lot more tame than you would think. I mean,
no, don't say that.
It is. I've been on some country sessions. I've been on some country sessions that were a lot more vulgar and you know, disgusting. No, I won't name names. But no, with Dre, I think it was always a lot of fun, and it was always very loose, and, you know, but Dre, you know, I think he imposed a lot of that respect. You know, like, a lot of people would come knowing they were getting their shot to work with Dre, and even Snoop, like, after all those years, when Snoop showed up, like, he was on his best behavior, you know, he was like, he doesn't get to work with Dre every day, and I think a lot of people who showed up went with that kind of reverence of like, okay, I'm getting my shot to work with Dre. I know I've got to impress him, otherwise he won't want to work with me again, no matter how big you are. But, you know, there was a lot of fun, but there was a lot of work. And so you'd see some guys drinking every once in a while and some green, organic substances, you know. But it was never outrageous. It was always just there to work, and you know, there were times maybe after hours, you know, that stuff would happen. But during the sessions, it was usually, it was very light and but also very hard working at the same time. But you would never know. I mean, as far as what you see in the videos and what you see, you know, that's a whole other thing. That they're portraying and a different lifestyle, but in the studio, everybody was usually there to impress Dre, no matter how big you were.
I just fully imagine like crystal everywhere, and then someone drives into the studio in a Thunderbird, and then a tiger walks in, and a woman swings along.
No, not so much.
No?
No, none of that. None of that. I mean, and the great thing too is Dre, you know, and I learned a lot of lessons from him. I could, you know, spend hours and hours talking about all the lessons, but I remember there's a story I can share that I always go back to, and it basically didn't matter how big of an artist you were or how, you know, developing of an artist or, you know, new of an artist you were. I remember Dre had some studio time booked with a new artist, a new rapper that he was thinking of signing, and he had the session booked, and we were all there to try and write some music for this artist. And he gets a phone call, and it's from Mary J. Blige. And we had just worked on a song called Family Affair. And so this was, you know, they everyone felt like it was gonna be the first single for this next record. And so Mary, Dre had done the mix, and Mary wanted to come by and hear the mix. And Dre said, well, I am in a session, so you can't come today, but you can come tomorrow. And hung up, you know, got off the phone and whatever, and thought that was the end of it. Well, Mary calls Jimmy Iovine, and I'm sorry if Mary somehow gets it. It doesn't really look bad on her, but it essentially, she calls Jimmy Iovine and said, hey, I'm in town, I want to hear this session. I mean, I want to hear this song, this mix. And so Jimmy calls Dre, and Dre's like, nope. He goes, Mary, I can't have her come because I'm working on another thing, and it would be disrespectful to him for me to cancel or stop the session for Mary. And so Mary calls again, and Dre just said, look, I don't know what to tell you, but you can come tomorrow. And so a few hours goes by, and one of Dre's security who walks the premises comes in, and he's like, Mary's outside the studio. And Dre said, yeah, don't let her in. And I remember everybody in the studio was like, and even the security guard was like, you're not gonna let Mary J. Blige in? And I sort of, you know, I've heard rumors, I heard a little bit of it, but obviously Mary wasn't very happy about that and had a few, you know, loudly spoken words to the security guard. But after her kind of trying to plead for even 10 minutes outside the studio, Dre didn't let her in. And he just sort of said, look, you know, I'm here to work with this artist. It doesn't matter how big you are or how much of a name. And, you know, he just treats everyone with respect. And you know, that was a big lesson for me to see, you know.
Yes.
So that gives a little insight into who Dre is.
So you must have found this so many times with the people that you've worked with. Ego. You know, like what you've just described, you will have worked with people with really, really big egos. How do you then, as a producer, go into that environment and navigate those egos and still have some kind of a creative impact? How do you not get pushed around and forced into stuff? And how do you exercise some kind of creative influence when you're dealing with people who have got that level of, I guess, confidence and insistence and what they want? And
right. Phil Spector used to carry a gun with him. So I didn't go that far. No, I don't know. I basically try and I just try and gain people's trust. You know, that's really, as a producer, that's the first step. It's just to gain the trust of the people I'm working with. If it's an artist, if it's the musicians, the band, whoever, just try and gain their trust. And then I don't know. It's funny. It just depends. I think one of my gifts, I guess, if you want to call it this, is sort of being a chameleon enough to realize who I'm dealing with and how they need to be communicated to. Mm-hmm. And so some people, you know, it's very straightforward. With other people, you kind of have to be sensitive about how you say things, and you just sort of, I just try and quickly adapt to whoever I'm working with, and figure out the best way to get the end result, so that they feel good about it, rather than being heavy-handed or, or just sort of imposing my will on it. And sometimes it does get a little tense, and you gotta, you know, if you feel like someone's really making a bad, you know, you're maybe dealing with someone who doesn't want to give in out of stubbornness, and you kind of have to navigate through that. But at the end of the day, I just try and gain people's trust and figure out the best way to communicate with them. But yeah, I mean, we all have egos, and you know, I have one, and you know, you just try and figure out the best way to get to the finish line together.
So do you find then in that situation that there will be ideas and things like that? One, like you might have the idea of your life and you might suggest it to the person that you're working with, and they'll go, nah. Yeah. What do you do with the, what do you do with all of the other great ideas? What happens to the stuff that ends up kind of waiting for another incarnation somewhere else?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't really get too precious about where the idea comes from, where it comes from. I just try and my job is to try and take, not only maybe I have the great idea, but to recognize the great idea as well. So it can come from anybody in the room, and I'm, as long as it's something that feels like it's going to make the song better or the production better, then I'm all for it, you know. But sometimes if you're working with a band where there's four or five different people that all have ideas, and sometimes they conflict with the other ideas, that's where it gets tricky. But going back to the trust, I feel like if I've earned all of their trust, I can kind of help, you know, be that mediator and get, you know, get some resolve and not you know try and prevent an argument or something like that. But yeah, I don't know. I don't really. To me, it's just throwing out ideas. There's no right or wrong. You're just kind of throwing them out there and seeing what excites people at the end of the day. That's all I really care about. I don't, the way I kind of approach it, and it's like sort of, I guess, a bass player mentality. It's like, you know, most people choose the bass not to be the star or the spotlight, you know, and we're usually there to sort of support the rest of the band members and try and make them sound better. And I think that's sort of the philosophy that I've tried to take as a producer and a writer, is just try and figure out the artist and figure out who I'm working with and do anything possible to make them sound their best. And
there's actually scientific evidence that was released today that Lydia Jenkins drew my attention to, saying that the bass is the most important aspect of a song.
Of course.
Scientifically proven.
Yeah, no debate there. I've known that for years.
And the bass does things like it inspires greater confidence in people. And
there you go. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think the bass is just one of those subliminal things. Sometimes you realize what it's doing and sometimes you don't, but yeah, it's the glue between the rhythm and the harmony, and I'm grateful that I found it, you know, or it found me. It's definitely, you know, I think studying that instrument and how it works within the context of any music, whether it be orchestral, jazz, rock, pop, you know, is for me is what all of the music that I've learned how to make is that's the foundation.
So the bass then is your strong muscle. Do you, when you kind of go into a situation with people, is that the first thing you start with? Do you find you gravitate to it?
Or? It just depends on what I'm feeling like. I don't know. There's some times where I won't play the bass for weeks, which is weird to think about. But I don't really start with the bass. But I usually, once there's a song, I have to make sure that the vocal, the drums, and the bass are all somehow communicating right.
Right.
Those are definitely the most important in terms of just that spectrum, as far as what the rhythm is and that heartbeat, what the low end and how it's functioning, and then ultimately what the vocal's doing. And then everything else is sort of just the glue and adding extra ear candy or harmony to support what that melody is.
Because it's quite kind of mystifying to imagine which component of that is composing, which component of that is playing, and which component of that is producing, because you do all three of those things and in different capacities for different people, and yet there's kind of something holistic about that trio of things, that trinity of things.
Yeah, I don't know, I just show up and things just happen. I don't know.
What's the magic formula?
It's a mystery to me. It is a mystery to me. Like, I mean, to me, that's like the best feeling though, when you show up, you're at a studio or your bedroom or whatever, and you're with maybe one or two other people, and then by the end of that encounter, you know, there's very possibly a song, you know, with a message, and maybe somebody will hear it beyond that room, and then it grows, you know, but it didn't exist before that day, you know. That's the buzz that I'm always after every day.
So early in your career, you were kind of in a situation where you had been offered a job as a bass player in a band called Linkin Park. And right. Then you were also having an opportunity to work with Dr. Dre, which, you know, given what we've just been talking about now, with all of those things being so similar, it must have felt like you had to make a choice.
Well, you know, at the time, though, it was an interesting thing. It wasn't like I knew it was Linkin Park was going to go on to be Linkin Park. I was, for the first time, being given writer's credit within Dre's camp, and it was going to be for the second Eminem record, Marshall Mathers LP, which, again, at that time, no one knew it was going to go on to sell as many records. No one knew the real Slim Shady was going to be as huge. And, you know, but I had gotten a phone call from a guy named Mike, who was in a band called Hybrid Theory, and his bass player had left, and they were looking for a bass player, and he came over to the house and played me the music, and it was pretty heavy, which was obviously my background. And I'm like, man, I had this dilemma, you know, maybe the stuff with Dre and Eminem was gonna work. In hindsight, it's like, yeah, duh, you know. But at the time, this band sounded like it might be cool, you know, maybe I should give that a shot. I've always wanted to be in a band and tour the world. So he played it for me on Friday, and he gave me over the weekend, and kind of talked to my wife about it. You know, I just got married not that long, and the thought of touring, and that played a big factor into it. And you know, we wanted to start having kids soon. So I just decided to go with my gut and chose Dre. But it wasn't until about a year after that they're on the cover of Rolling Stone, and it's Linkin Park, and I didn't really put two and two together, that their album was called Hybrid Theory. And I'm like, wait a minute, that guy looks like the Mike who called me. That's Mike Shinoda. And so literally at one point, I mean, you know, fortunately I had someone looking after me. I had the great choice between choosing to be, you know, a part of Dre and Eminem's camp or be in Linkin Park somehow. So I don't know. I feel like I made the right choice.
So talking about the real Slim Shady, it would be fascinating to kind of dive into the details of that song as an example of something that you've done that's absolutely iconic.
Really? I mean, were any of these people born? You guys even know that song? No. Really? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, no, I'm playing.
I know we all look really young.
I mean, The Real Slim Shady was basically, at the end of a record, sometimes, you know, you kind of go, okay, look, we feel like we've got the first single, we feel like the album's done, but, you know, through Jimmy Iovine, who kind of inspired Dre and Em to, like, just take a couple weeks and see what happens. Maybe there's a new song that comes out of it. And there was no pressure, and we're just kind of goofing around in the studio, really. We felt, like I said, everyone felt like the album was done. There was already a song that was going to be the first single. So sometimes in that looseness, you get a song, you know, that you didn't expect to get.
Yep.
And so me and a keyboard player named Tommy Koster Jr. Were just in the studio. I don't even think anybody else was in there at the time. And there was a drum beat that Dre had, you know, a leftover drum beat on the drum machine. And we just started playing together. And it sort of had this sort of like, we kind of approached it as almost sort of classical hip hop. You know,
right,
if you really dissect
yeah.
it, it's kind of a harpsichord kind of, you know, Baroque-y kind of thing. And, you know, and also for me, I was trying to, you know, sometimes what I'll do in those situations is like try and pick the most random abstract things and mesh them together. So for me, there was a song on Dre's 2001 record called The Next Episode. And that was always one of my favorites. And it's actually one that I didn't play on. And it was a sample that's the bulk of that track. But it just had such a great feel and toughness. And the bass line was so sick. So I was trying to do The Next Episode meets some Bach chorale or something, you know, and that's basically what we did. We just tried to find this quirky little thing, and Marshall kind of tends at that time especially tended to gravitate towards anything that felt cartoonish,
yeah.
that he could say the most insane thing on top of,
yeah.
and that contrast really worked well for him. So he came into the studio, heard it, and fortunately it went on to do what it did.
So I apologize for this question in advance, but who went who did that?
Yeah, it was both of us. It was basically Tommy on the keyboards, me on a bass sound, and we just kind of figured out this little counterpoint thing at the same time. So sometimes there were songs like that would happen, and that was the best part about Dre, was he always had guys that were really great at collaborating and coming up with ideas at the same time.
Yep.
One crazy, sometimes we get so used to being in the room with one another, we would read each other's minds. And I still to this day don't know how it happened, but there is a song called Let Me Blow Your Mind by Eve and Gwen Stefani. And I played, that one started out by me playing guitar. So I just played that little, right? So I started that, and right at the same time, Scott Storch, who was also in the room, another, you know, incredible person to collaborate with. And I don't know how, I even asked him, like, how did you do this? I literally went, doo, 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 and then on the downbeat, he had the clap up. Like, he just answered. So that was always what would happen. I would play something, and somebody else would try and find an answer or a counterpoint to what we did. And he happened to just had the right key, and it literally happened within a split second. And Dre said, what the hell was that? And we're like, we don't know, it just happened. So we quickly, you know, put it to tape, which back in those days, we recorded everything to tape. And it became, you know, a big song for Eve and Gwen Stefani. But it was always, you know, that's my favorite thing. And that's why I think the band mentality comes back. You know, I love being in a band and working with two or three other people and collaborating, and the best idea wins. And with Dre, and even now, you know, what I do today, I always have people that I love being inspired by and who are going to enhance any idea that gets put out there.
And do you still love that opportunity to be able to just simply, instead of kind of sitting in a studio environment and crafting a whole lot of different elements and interacting with other people, do you still retreat into that kind of private world of simply playing music and just simply performing on the bass?
Yeah, I mean, I have some friends that I'll do, you know, just local gigs in Los Angeles. Yeah. Usually it winds up being more just like I've got some friends that are some really great bluegrass musicians, so we'll get together and play a bunch of bluegrass gigs, and I'll play my double bass, and then a lot of jazz gigs as well. It was a big part of my life, it still is, in terms of music that I just enjoy listening to, and just to sort of, you know, do something completely different than the music that I'm typically making. It just sort of gives me a little bit of a chiropractic adjustment, almost, sort of like go do a jazz gig and I kind of come back with some fresh ears and a whole other perspective. But I'll play maybe once or twice a month or something like that.
So also, you were mentioning earlier that, you know, you had just started out and you got married and you were about to start having children. You subsequently had four children.
Right. Who were with me. They came on this trip.
Yeah. Including twins.
Right. Absolutely.
How on earth does that all fit together? How do you go from being in the studio and everyone's like, yo, and then and then you go home and there are screaming twins?
I know. The funny thing is that the people at the studio listen to me more than my kids do. So it's actually a lot easier to be in the studio sometimes.
Yeah.
But no, I think, you know, the environment in the studio, it's, you know, it's usually just productive and people are usually respectful and whatnot. I mean, I think the biggest thing for me was just sort of adjusting my workflow, my workload, and it caused me to sort of be very selective and try to find things that I knew I really loved, and not just doing it because it was a gig. And that provided me more opportunity. And I found that it sort of worked in a cycle that if I was doing less work but more things that I loved, then those would be those that had a better shot at being successful, and the more success I had, the more selective I could be, and then spend more time with my family.
Yeah. Are those decisions easy when you hear something and you can maybe hear potential in it, or maybe you can hear that there's a lot of work to do but there's a seed there, or maybe something's fully formed? How do you weigh up what you really, you know, given that you probably got quite a beautiful platter of things to choose from, how do you pick?
I don't know. I just kind of go with my gut. Sometimes I don't know. It's weird. It's just some things just sort of line up, and I don't really freak out if I can't do something. If something doesn't work out, it just wasn't meant to be. I'm really fortunate that I'm in a place where more things get offered than I can do. But I always try and balance it out with doing things that are new or developing or on the cusp of maybe going big. 21 Pilots, for instance, was one that I actually sought them out and just kept bugging their A&R guy. You know, after their last record came out, I just thought it would be really cool. And I actually thought that they were primed for that just big explosion. And and it kind of worked out, you know. So I'm always looking for things that are either super early or things that are almost on the verge of having a breakout, but also are a little bit left, a little bit different than mainstream. And sometimes it works out, and other times it just becomes a little cult classic. But I try and do my best to do things that I feel are going to get me future work and the types of things that I want, and never do something that I'm just going to do for a paycheck, but, you know, potentially could hurt my chances. You know, everyone looks at credits, or, you know, as far as artists, when they'll go on and you know, if they're considering working with you, but they see a credit in there that looks a little, you know, suspect, then they might not call you. So I just try and be a little bit aware of that, but most of the time I just don't care. I just kind of do what I feel like, you know, seems like the right thing to be doing at that moment. But.
So across the course of your, you know, the decades of your career, you will have seen the music industry and the values, you know, the aesthetics of the industry, the aesthetics of what people listen to, and not just that, but how it's consumed and how it's purchased and experienced change profoundly. And you're now in a position where you are also at Warner Brothers as an A&R person, looking into what's up and coming and thinking about who to develop and who to sign. What are the changes that you've seen?
Yeah, I mean, about 6 years ago, I got offered an opportunity to do A&R for Warner Brothers, and I took that as a way to sort of be an extension of developing artists and being able to do more old-fashioned A&R the way that I saw it towards the, you know, the late 80s and early 90s and early 2000s. And a lot of the stories that you hear about how A&R people would sign, and, you know, you look at groups like U2, who didn't even have singles until their third or fourth record, really. And I just saw that as being something that was sort of dying, you know, and you have to have like, you know, millions of streams on Spotify before a record label will even look at you now. So that there's positive in that for sure. I'm always struggling to try and find things that need nurturing and need to be developed and coached a little bit before they can go on to have success. Mm-hmm. But it, you know, it's tough. It's one of those things where you just do what you know, depending on what things start coming to you. I'm not one that kind of does a lot of like blog research or anything like that. It ends up being more just organic, and someone gives me a record, or I happen to go see somebody play and fall in love with it and want to work with them and try and develop it. But I think, you know, in terms of your question, I mean, I don't know if it's a question, but in terms of like how much of it's changed, I mean, I think now anybody has a shot at being, you know, successful. I mean, I think in terms of, you know, you putting something out and having somebody hear it and developing an artist can be really, really cool. The flip side of that is that, you know, there's a barrage of, it's a bunch of stuff to sort of sift through. And, you know, for me, it was always great being able to go to a record store and see these artists that had been curated by, you know, producers and talented A&R who sort of like handpicked the best of the best. Mm. And so discovering music can be tricky sometimes, but I think ultimately it's a positive thing. Mm. You know, anyone should be able to have the shot at, you know, being heard and not having to rely on a major label record deal, you know. So there's, you know, a good amount of times where I'm helping artists develop and not being able to sign them, but kind of coaching them and giving them some advice to hopefully having their music heard. And then once there are that million streams, you know, being able to go in and maybe sign them if it works out.
What do you look for?
I mean, I look for, you know, I mean, there's a number of different things. I mean, I definitely look for someone's perspective, like their point of view and their voice lyrically is probably the most important thing. What they're talking about and what kind of audience I feel like they might want to reach, and whether there is an audience for what they want to say. And ultimately, you know, yeah, as far as the ability to write, if they are a type of artist that needs to write their own songs, you know, then that's obviously very crucial. Or maybe they have great ideas, but they just need somebody to sort of help wrangle them in. This isn't usually a problem, but you know, I obviously there needs to be something that I feel you know, some intangible stuff that, like, whether what they represent is going to impact somebody's life, you know, and not just sort of, I don't typically sign things that are just going to be sort of a, have a short shelf life. It's just going to be something that, that is a hit on, you know, novelty kind of thing. You know, I try and look for something that, that, you know, I look at some of my favorite bands and artists growing up and tried to feel like, okay, could this artist be that version to this generation, be that, you know, so I kind of, I don't know, it sort of changes, but it, in a nutshell, it's sort of their point of view as a lyricist and what they represent artistically.
I wonder now if there are any questions from people here in the audience. I'm sure that we have time to take a few. Yes.
So it seems like the idea of producing these slightly different things are different people. I'm wondering if someone approached you off the street, like a layman who wasn't necessarily a musician, asked you what a producer does, what would you give it as an answer?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, it does vary. And different producers produce different way. Myself, I feel I'm there to, you know, be a motivator, to be an arranger, to, you know, to sort of get out of the way when I when someone, you know, just is already off doing something great. You know, you just sort of allow it to happen. But it's, you know, it's somewhat of a, you know, sort of a therapist at times, and but someone who understands, you know, what the artist is trying to achieve, you know, and some artists are trying to achieve, you know, mega world domination, and some just want to have a cool little vibey following, and so depending on what those artists are looking to accomplish, I'm just there to try and help figure out of the most efficient and productive way and creative way to get their vision across. So yeah, it's but it can be any, and as far as what you have to do to do that can mean many different things. But I'm just trying to basically, you know, get an artist that hopefully has a vision for themselves. Those are usually the best ones, and you're just trying to help them navigate in a studio, you know, the most creative way to get to the finish line.
Yes, down the back.
You talked earlier about the cooperative environment in the studio life, Dr. Gray. This is a kind of question that everyone comes into at some stage. Is in America or in your world, is there a standard that works for sorting out splits on songs?
Songs?
What contributions actually constitute? Because these are things that can break up a band.
You know? Right. Yeah, I mean, as far as bands are concerned, most bands have their own arrangement internally, even before they come in and work with maybe a co-writer. And I, you know, it's always good to just sort of be upfront. So myself, I'll usually go to the manager and say, okay, if I'm working with two or three guys, you know, or sometimes more, yeah, how do they split? Are they just splitting everything equally, or is one the primary writer? But if it's just sort of a, you know, a normal, you know, two or three people in a room, it's always equal as far as the way I do it. Most people do it, and even if it's three people and one of the persons maybe didn't do, you know, we don't try and look back at the session and go, oh, well, you only came up with, you know, so and so many lines, or didn't come up with as much melody or context. It doesn't really matter. I feel like the end result wouldn't have been the same without all the individuals in the room, so we just split things equally. And there's times where I maybe show up and I didn't have as much to contribute, and it sort of balances itself out, you know. But yeah, if it's just a straight writing session, it's usually just equal splits for the people in the room. Occasionally it can get a little dicey when you have a song, maybe two people have written with an artist, and then the label decides or somebody decides that another one or two people need to, you know, take a stab at, you know, retooling it or changing it, and that can get a little, you know, odd or whatever, and figuring out what something you thought you had a third, now you're sort of without knowing or having any say in who the other writers were going to be, That happens every once in a while, but most of the time it's pretty fair. But I have been in awkward situations where, you know, you work with people. It's usually people who don't have the experience who try and be a little bit more nitpicky about, like, no, I think you should get 8.2 and I'm going to get, you know, this point 80, you know, whatever. It, to me, it's just not that serious. I typically go with whatever's, you know, going to make the artist happy. And if in those situations, it's not that big of a deal to me. Well, you know, it depends. As far as getting paid to do songwriting sessions, is that what your question is? Yeah. Yeah. No, I don't. I mean, I know that there's some people who can, you know, request that and get paid a good amount of money just to walk in the room. I'm not. That's not really, you know, what I do. I just basically just show up and write, and you know, you hope for the best. But I mean, obviously, you know, you hope that something's successful, and if it is successful on you know, on a global scale, then that provides you some comfort, or you know, some padding to, you know, if you're smart with your money and save it, then you know string it along to the next one. But as a producer, you get paid advances and certain, you know, amounts of royalty depending on what you produce. So sometimes I can make money obviously as a producer once I'm actually making the record, but as a songwriter, you're just showing up and, you know, you're just creating and hope for the best. Mm. Yeah.
When I was living abroad as a musician, I did a few collaborative sessions and wrote with both producers and artists for myself and for other people. I thought it was really rewarding, but when I moved back to New Zealand, I found that people are a little bit more precious about the idea of collaborating or having someone
Yeah, I mean, as far as collaborating, to me, I'm always interested in learning new ways of doing things and people's backgrounds and how they even came to become a songwriter or a producer or whatnot, or a musician or an artist, you know. So to me, it's just getting to know people, getting to know, like, what their strengths are and how we work together for that moment and that day, and sometimes, you know, onward. So I look at it as more in terms of who am I stepping inside a room with and getting to know, like, what's going on in their life. I try to not have it be this cold, like, okay, we're here, we're going to write a song and it's going to be this tempo and it's going to be in this key because that's what works. You know, I try and just be a little bit more, just sort of get in a room and get to know people and find out that someone that I know, like, what's going on in their lives. And I find, like, through that conversation, everyone kind of puts their guard down. I try and just go in and just communicate and just see what's going on. Sometimes out of that becomes the song, you know, sometimes that discussion or that thought, you know. But there's times where you work with people who are a bit more close-minded or precious, like you say, and you just avoid them, I guess, you know. I just sort of... You have those sessions and you kind of go, okay, well, that really wasn't that inspiring or wasn't that collaborative, and just choose to move on and find other people that you connect with and who are more open to wanting to try different things, and, you know, just keep working with them. But to me, it's always beneficial to just keep an open mind and to just hear everyone's ideas out and try them and see what works. And even if you feel like you know exactly the right way to go, I'm happy to be proven wrong. Like, I feel like that's exciting when someone else has a cool idea and you're just like, wow, I would have never have thought to go there. But let's see what happens. So
it's interesting because in New Zealand, I think, and what you're alluding to is that the line between artist and writer is much fainter, because artists and writers are often the same thing here. There's a fierce independence and a kind of a self-contained creative...
Yeah, it's like people, they don't want to collaborate because they'll be seen as not competent enough if somebody else isn't willing to write their song. And I, I kind of feel like people need to just collaborate more.
Yeah, more yeah. I mean, at least my experience in the States is that, you know, artists are super open to collaborating and wanting to get the best songwriters they can, you know, and especially ones that have had success, you know, typically it's for a reason. And so you can go and, you know, even as an artist can get better by working with a great songwriter, you know, and learn how to become a better writer. At the end of the day, that's, you know, that's all you hope to do is get better and better. How do you get, I mean, there's no formula other than just doing it. You know, for me, again, it's just trying to meet and collaborate with new people and always keeping it fresh and always keeping new people there.
Genres?
I try and stick to genres that I feel honestly that I can contribute to. I don't really do anything that I don't think, you know, that I'm just faking it. You know, I try and be honest and go, you know, rather than just doing a session just to do it, I try and like make sure that the people that I'm working with or the style that they're expecting is something that I can honestly contribute to and feel good about, rather than just go in and fake it. But I just, you know, to me, you get better by just doing it and being open to other people's ideas and see how they do it and take bits, you know, from everyone that you come into contact with.
Mm. Yes.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many different ways. I you know, put it to you like this. I actually signed an artist to Warner Brothers who was a rapper who didn't know how to make beats and didn't know anybody who made beats. And he scoured SoundCloud and found beats that he liked and then emailed those guys, reached out to them. One guy happened to be in Scandinavia, another guy in Texas, another guy. And we ended up putting out that record on Warner Brothers. And there were all things that we ended up having to go to like these six different producers all over the place and ask them if we could use their beats and, you know, went through the proper way of getting it. But the music that I heard were things that he had done without even being in the same room with you. So that was just the way that he chose to do it. But I mean, I think, you know, by you know, I would imagine APRA, I mean, there's loads of producer, you know, songwriters that maybe, you know, maybe there's workshops or maybe there's different types of things where you can kind of like seek out. And obviously the people who are having success are going to require payment, you know, so that becomes difficult. So you're kind of looking for maybe someone who's sort of at the same level as you in terms of, you know, someone who's just looking for the experience and the opportunity, and maybe you guys connect and have something that sparks and you know, one another. But I don't really know all of the different things that go on here, but I know that at least in the States, I'm always encouraging artists to sort of take part in a lot of these sort of, you know, songwriter workshops and different places where they can maybe go and interact, but you can probably find a lot of cool instrumental beat ideas and just try writing to them and see what happens. Maybe there's some type of music you can kind of go down that rabbit hole and find, you know, instrumental things that maybe aren't from, you know, people who don't live in New Zealand, but that kind of inspire you to write, and then you can, you know, sort of use those as ways to kind of enhance your profile.
I got sort of a related question.
Well, you know what? One second. You already had a question, so I want to maybe get to one other question.
There was one just here.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry.
Tools of your trade. What are the tools that you absolutely cannot write songs without?
Well, I always, you know, an acoustic guitar is definitely one of them. And, you know, I always have, most of the time I have Logic is the you know, the software that I use to record. So I've got all of my sounds and keyboards, drum sounds, all that stuff is usually in that. So even if it's just a quick little drum beat or it's just a piano or a road sound or whatever, Logic is something that I always usually, you know, record my ideas into. But just, you know, there's definitely been plenty of songs where just writing a song on acoustic guitar and then translating it into something that more of a production later. But yeah, Logic is probably the one tool I'd say that I use predominantly.
There was one over here.
Yeah.
What gets you up in the morning, and how have you kept up your motivation for 20 odd years?
Yeah, I mean, you know what? There's just, to me, it's like I said, it's the buzz of knowing that you've got the opportunity to create something that no one else but the people that you're about to go and hang with are going to create, and to have a song that hopefully is going to impact, you know, not only that artist but their audience, and I don't know, to me it's super thrilling to just, like, at the end of a day have a song hopefully finished or close to being finished, and then have that song go on a record or have it be released, you know, out to the world. And then, you know, I mean, to me also getting to go see it perform live, you know, a lot of the artists that I've gotten to work with recently, getting to go see some, you know, pretty big venues, and you know, you played a part in, like, you know, 3 or 4 days of crafting this song, and now, you know, there's 20,000 people singing along. Like, that's a pretty awesome feeling, and you just want to find a way to do it again, and you know, it's fun. I mean, I love what I get to do. You know, I've got a lot of toys in my studio that I get to play with every day, and I you know, it's a dream.
Yeah. My question was related to the technology and stuff, logic and what you're playing. I know lots of people will put forward the argument that everybody can get access to the gear. If you've got the right ideas, then you can just do your thing your way. I remember being quite struck when I read an interview with Chris Williams, Mike Jackson's engineer, where he was like, no, having all the awesomest gear in the whole world, that made a really big difference, and you can't just do what we did without it. So I'm curious about your take on, you know what's in the pro studios that you're working in, you know what's available to people for, you know, $50 kind of plugins that they buy, or the free ones, or whatever. How great does that divide really? Like, do you use all the same things everybody else is using?
Yeah, I mean, I think it depends on the type of production and the type of record you're looking to make. But obviously there's tons of records that can be made off of a laptop and sound amazing and be exactly appropriate for what they're looking to achieve. My studio is a studio where a lot of really cool classic records were made, you know, and so I enjoy having a studio, and the gear that I've acquired over the years is definitely gives you more options. But in terms of, you know, I think what Bruce, you know, Sudan was maybe talking about, you know, in terms of, like, making Thriller, I don't think you could have made Thriller in a hotel room or in your bedroom. Like, that type of record and that production of that era required having a studio. But that's not to say that, you know, different types of productions can't be made fully on a laptop and, you know, a USB mic and, you know, and have it sound just as huge, or have it do just as well.
It kind of goes back a little bit to that collaborative conversation about letting other people into your work, because today there are so many people at home with their gear thinking that they can be an instrumentalist, a producer, a composer, a mixer, a masterer, and then somehow get something out into the world that's going to have the same impact as an album like Thriller, which had Quincy Jones and it had, you know, all of these other people and amazing influences making themselves known and felt in that kind of an environment.
I mean, I think it just depends on your means, you know. I mean, obviously Michael Jackson had a budget and was able to hire all the best arrangers and horn players and musicians and Quincy and the studio time. So it just depends on, you know, just doing the most and being creative with what you have available to you. Sometimes the limitations are really good. But I think it's always good to be able to, like, get out of your bubble a little bit, even if it's inviting someone to come in and play on some of your things, or, you know, a buddy of yours, or and then maybe you've got a friend who's a great engineer, give him a shot or her a shot at mixing it and seeing what it sounds like through someone else's ears. And just, you know, finding at some point in the process to collaborate or bring someone else in, I think is healthy for sure.
You.
I just wondering, are there areas as a songwriter you're quite curious to try out? So I'm just thinking of, like, you know, the success of Hamilton in terms of crossover.
Yeah, I mean, I actually got to, did you say Hamilton?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I actually got to work on Hamilton. I worked on the mixtape that came out. And Lynn, I actually have known Lynn for about 7 years, so it was amazing to see all of this happen to an extremely talented guy. But yeah, I think the musical genre is definitely, you know, blowing up. I think what Lynn's done is inspiring a lot of people. I actually have an 8-year-old who loves Hamilton, loves everything about it. And you know, and is actually, you know, he's like, yeah, I think I want to write a musical, you know? So, I mean, that kind of stuff to me is just, it does nothing but good, you know? I don't know myself. It usually, you know, most musicals, and especially in Lynn's case, can take anywhere from 4 to 6 years from writing and composing to even getting a shot at having it, you know, premiere somewhere, let alone get to Broadway. I mean, it's a tough, cutthroat business. So I don't, you know, it's not something that I would just think, oh, you know, I'm just gonna go and try that out and see what happens. It would require probably some, you know, strong guidance to maybe work with somebody who's, you know, very prolific in that area to see what would happen. But yeah, I don't know. At this point, I don't know if there's like a genre of music that I'm like trying to break into. You know, I've done some things for film that have been pretty fun. I don't know. At this point, I still love writing songs too much to think that I could even be good at doing film composing, but you never know. Maybe at some point, you know, that might be a calling. I know this woman's actually really good at it. You know, but it's something that I love the idea of writing music in a completely different context than a 3.5 minute, you know, little nugget. You know, you're trying to convey something completely different. But in a lot of ways, what I did, I felt in what I did with Dre, was almost sort of little mini compositions, because you'd have Eminem walk in sometimes and go, well, I want to write a song that's, you know, that's makes you feel like this and this and this, and you're trying to write a little mini score to, you know, to what he wanted to talk about. And a lot of times my productions, I feel I'm trying to enhance whatever the mood or the theme of the lyric is. So, you know, you never know, maybe that might work out someday.
You had a question.
Yeah, it's kind of long-winded, but basically, like, in the industry, we see a lot of independent artists before the record label comes along, and they've got a catalog, and once the record label comes along, they sort of just expunge their catalog and pretend like, you know, they've never recorded anything, and then maybe, like, 2 years go by, and they record a single, and they release it, and they're all of a sudden dubbed new artists.
Right.
Is that kind of formulaic of a record label to just kind of, I guess, reinvent the artist?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think that most labels now are looking for independent artists that have released, you know, songs or have a buzz and have, you know, a following before they're even, you know, it can be in any genre. You know, like if you've put something out and you've got some streams, you've got some good, you know, social, you know, media followers or whatever. You know, to me, most labels are actually looking for that exact same thing and building off of it rather than completely trying to change them or rebrand, as you said. My experience has been most labels are kind of like either looking for bands or artists that were signed to independent labels and have put out one or two records and are with, you know, at that point where they're ready to maybe break a bit more mainstream. Those tend to be the ones that are the most sought after artists. But another flip side of that is I think it's amazing. I mean, one of my favorite artists right now is Chance the Rapper. And you look at Chance, like Chance actually hasn't released an album for sale. Everything he's put out has been free and streamed, you know, so for him to go and validate that by winning Grammys and have all the success, I think is healthy for the label, and I think it kind of keeps the labels on their toes to, you know, look at some of these independent artists and what they're doing and you know, and take them seriously.
Hi, just how you think about science and sound in general. Is there like a mental checklist that you always go through, or biggest aha moments, or epiphanies, or lessons learned about, like, so cut speakers up and listen to the mix? And like,
yeah, I mean, I just want to make sure that nothing is covering up the vocal. To me, everything has got to support what's being said and what the voice, you know, what depending on the genre of music, you know, it still always goes back to the vocal. So I always try and make sure that the voice and the beat and the bass are always, you know, somehow all collaborating with one another. And then, you know, guitars and all that, and keyboards, depending on what else, like those kind of play off of it. But, you know, I try not to add too much clutter to things that I produce. And just because I've got gear to like feel like I've got to use it, and you've got 10,000 plugins and soft synths that you've got to use, you know, I try and use the least amount of things that you can get away with almost sometimes. But it depends though, what type of record I'm making And, you know, I think that's probably one of the hardest jobs of a producer is knowing when to stop and knowing when to say, okay, this is done, and either convincing themselves or the artist that, you know, we don't need to tinker anymore. This is done. This is great. Let's move on.
Do you know anything in particular that Dr. Dre told you about how to conceptualize sound?
Not really. I mean, I think you just 11 years of just seeing him, you know, construct, I think is, you know, sort of rubbed off somehow. I'd like to hope, you know, but there wasn't any dialogue that we had where he explained it, broke it down, you know, and I think, but if you look at Dre's productions, you'll see that most of them don't have a lot of clutter, and the voice and the drums have a lot to do with the impact, and everything else is sort of, you know, helps the bounce, and you know, you try to not make sure you have too many things competing in the same sort of sonic spectrum, not a lot of things up here competing with the vocal. But if they do have, I also, one of the things that I love doing is sort of having these little musical handoffs. So if you have something playing a sound, maybe a new thing and a different register plays in its space. So if something's playing over here on the first half of the bar, another type of sound is playing on the back half. I love when I can find little things like that, but I don't know. There aren't a lot of formulas that I use. It's more to just sort of song by song, mm-hmm. artist by artist, you know.
Mm-hmm. As a vocalist songwriter myself, I normally come from writing the lyrics first and then trying to set music to it. But with all your experience, how often do you find that it's actually might be around the other way, where the music evolves first and then the lyrics come later?
Yeah, I mean, sometimes that is the case. Sometimes you get in a room and you can just sense that somebody wants to sit at a piano and write a song, and you've got to go with that. I mean, but there are other times where you feel like somebody wants a sense of a beat or something to sort of, you know, try ideas off of. So a lot of times I'll just quickly throw up a beat and try and find a chord progression or a cool little hook musically to just sort of start the idea. But a lot of times that can change once you know what the melody is. Once you know what the lyric and the song's going to be about, a lot of times I'll go back and change what maybe started the idea to suit what the idea has become. So it's just sort of a constant, you know, ebb and flow of, like, once the lyric and melody's there, I'm like, oh, you know what, that sound doesn't quite work with what they're saying, you know, so I'll change it or alter it, but maybe it got the idea going. But plenty of times where you just sit and you're just banging out chords and you're getting the melody before you even think about what kind of drum beat or track or sound you're going to put to it.
But would you generally have the lyrics already pretty much sketched out?
There's times, yeah. There's definitely been times where you've written a complete song just sitting at, you know, at a piano or acoustic guitar, and you've got everything written, and then you figure out a way to produce it. I'll say that's, you know, very often. Not all the time, but that happens pretty often.
What about the other side, that people might just have a beat or something and then
yeah.
build it the other way? Is that
yeah,
common?
That's very common. Yeah, there's times where I'll have like a beat going and people will start singing, improvising melodies, you know, and sometimes you got a couple people or everyone who has got ideas, and I always have a mic ready to go. So if an idea is going, I've always got a mic ready to record. If someone's like, all right, let me just try this, and, you know, it just, you know, sometimes people like to even put, like, auto-tune on their voice, and that way they know that they're going to sing in key, right, but they're just going to, like, sort of sing around, and they know every note they hit. Sometimes they might think they're hitting another note, but they accidentally hit another one, and that actually sounds really cool, and that becomes a melody, you know. So there's no right or wrong way to do it. I've done sessions where I've had auto-tune on my voice and just start singing melodies and something, you know, pops out that everyone loves and we're like, cool, yeah, let's go with that, you know. I just, whatever kind of keeps it up and creative, you know, I don't really feel like it has to be one way or the other.
I'm getting the sense that the moral of the story is flexibility, open-mindedness, willingness to try anything, willingness to take on board ideas from all of the people around you.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And in a sense, kind of the willingness to let go, let go of things.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, let go in the sense of like letting other people take charge, you mean? Mm. Like, yeah.
And let go of, I guess, your own commitment to your own ideas sometimes when you then get more ideas coming in. Yeah. So you make room for them, you make room in the sonic spectrum, you make room in the mental spectrum.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and also letting go in terms of, like, sometimes you start an idea. Not every idea you start needs to be finished, you know. I think, you know, just trying to be productive and be honest, you know, sometimes you start something and you're like, ah, this isn't that great, you know, let's start something else. And just to be willing to do that and just to, you know, make sure that you're not, like, forcing yourself to finish something that doesn't need to be finished. You know, sometimes there are plenty of times where you know, maybe we'll start one or two things and those two things led us to the really great thing, the third go around. Mm. So just being open to that and not being like, okay, everything I write has to be, you know, the most incredible thing. You know, sometimes you got to go through the process a couple times to get to something really special.
Mike, we cannot thank you enough for being here to share
your
vast experience and wisdom with us.
I hope I made some sense. I don't know.
You did.
Sometimes I feel like I'm just rambling, but
not at all.
But yeah, so thank you for having me.
Thank you so much for coming.